Baptist Church of Gibson, Florida. It is so good to see all of you. There's a hymn book in the pew rack in front of you. And in your car dashboard, if you're listening on the radio, there's a hymn book laying right there on the dash.
If you like.
And if you don't have one of those, if you're watching out in the desert on the computer, you have some of these songs in your mind. But let's all sing together. What a friend we have in Jesus. The notes are on page 354. We'll sing verses 1 and 2, please. What a friend we have in Jesus.
The king is coming, the king.
We're looking forward, Father, to how you are going to bless the young people of this church as you're raising them up for the days ahead. We ask your comfort, your guidance, your protection from the evil one for each of our families and for our church and especially our youth in these days. Thank you for the remainder of this service and what you plan to do for us. We're going to thank you in advance. In Jesus' powerful name, we say amen. Amen. We'll sing two verses of Near the Cross, and the second verse will be our offertory verse. So let's just get ready for that second verse. We'll receive our evening call. Jesus,
hurt so bad they were going to amputate his legs and his arms and mercifully, God took him
Amen.
Out of that thing. So it's a real tragic situation.
But remember the wife here? It was his nephew.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, got killed here in Gibson just a few days ago. So he's here tonight and wanted us to remember the family in prayer.
We will remember that tragedy. Yes, Dave?
Tina Woods, it's in my Sunday school class. You heard Sunday that her sister passed away. And Richard talked to me and he said that this was her oldest sister that kind of took care of all the kids, and that she's really taken it hard. And he said that anyone that wants to send a card, you know, just check with the church office and we'll get you the address, or send flowers or call and Good. Give her a little bit of comfort.
Good. Well, y'all can help us, just like Tom thought of that JW, because we want to keep up with everybody, especially at this time. Forrest?
Brother Buddy, I got a praise and I got two prayer requests. I talked to Brother Scotty and he said the financial support is coming in. The churches are sending them.
Good.
Excellent. Praise,
Amen. Amen. And missions
I have two missionaries. I have Edgar, which is in Cambodia. We support him. And Gerald Tom. They broke into their churches and stole that out their music and everything.
Oh, same place?
Yeah.
Soundboards, everything. Yeah. They don't even have any mics there.
Yeah.
Man,
Lord. One's in Cambodia and one's now in Guyana.
Oh, wow. That's sad.
Yeah, just wipe them out.
You think they were in Gibson, wouldn't you?
No, I watched this place.
Yeah. Oh, that's for Jerry.
Down here. Buddy. What about Dave and his wife that sit up front here?
Rogers.
Rogers.
Yes.
Have y'all heard, anybody heard from them?
We have.
Oh, okay, because Cindy asked me to ask.
We've talked to them about a week and a half ago.
Okay.
They're doing good.
They're doing okay. Yeah. Good.
And remember, Lorraine and Sarah, that's right, because they're going to be driving back. She drove 1,000 miles to be with her mom.
Oh.
Amen. Amen.
Traveling back Friday, won't you, for traveling safety. Tom?
Ted Dean called me, or texted me on Sunday, and said there's a couple people from church called him, said that Pastor Max did a funeral. And he said Dean Cook, people thought they were using Ted Dean.
Yeah, Ted Dean.
Oh.
What now?
Ted Dean called me, texted me on Sunday, said two people from church, I don't know who they were, but they said that you did their funeral.
And it's been good to have the Lees. This is William Jorbeth's grandmother and granddad.
Amen.
Pray for her him because he said she's not behaving. All right, someone else? We're glad to have the McCartys.
Yes.
And they found us through the gospel concerts.
Amen.
That we have here. So we're just thrilled to have you all with us tonight.
Yes.
Anyone else for prayer tonight? Yes. I see that hand.
Remember my cousin in prayer. His name is Tommy Landrum. He's in his 60s, and he is dying of cancer. Hospice has been called. Just pray for him and his wife, Carolyn. They need a lot of prayer right now.
All right. Anyone else? Let's continue to pray for our pastor. He's been through a lot with all this stuff going on. And for Pat, she's been doing wonderful, thank God.
Amen.
And do we have unspoken requests tonight? All right. Forrest, how about leading us in our prayer time tonight, please, sir?
Our most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, as we come to Thee, Lord, we come with humble hearts tonight, God. We also thankful, dear God, because You're on the throne.
Yes.
And You said, dear Heavenly Father, God, You take care of us in this time, dear Heavenly Father, God. And we depend upon You, Father. And dear God, there's people in this church right now, dear God, that's not receiving their money. Heavenly Father, God, I pray
dear God, for the people, the members of our church, dear God, that you will open up the floodgates, Lord. Dear God, that they'll come down, Heavenly Father God, and they'll receive what they need, Heavenly Father God, to supply for their families, dear God. I pray for our nation, dear Heavenly Father God, yes. If this is what it takes, dear God, to bring it down to our knees, Heavenly Father God, and that we can be supported by Jesus Christ, dear God, we love you, Lord, and we want to serve you, but dear Heavenly Father God, as we come down the church here, dear God, I look down the street down here, the boat dock. The boats is running over down there on Sunday morning. And dear Heavenly Father God, I'm thankful that we have a church here in Gibson, dear God, that we can take and come and be in our house, Heavenly Father God, and worship you because you're our Savior. The Bible says, forsake not to assemble thyself in the house of the Lord. I'm so thankful, Heavenly Father God, that we got a church right here in Gibson. We got a pastor that's willing to stand, dear God, and be accounted, dear God, for our church, dear God. And we thank you. We thank you for the ones that's helped the church together by having church outside, dear Heavenly Father God. And we just give you praise, dear God. Thank you, God. We just give you, we lift up our holy hands, dear God, because you are worthy to be praised, and we do praise you in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. And now, let's give a fantastic welcome from First Baptist Church to Sister Lorraine Butler. She's going to sing for us.
I thought I would be what I want.
with her.
I do too.
Different way tonight than maybe you've ever heard it presented tonight, but I
I think it'll help us really appreciate our position that we have as husbands, leaders in our family. And all of it begins with verse number 17, that everything we do should bring honor and glory to the Heavenly Father. And so we look at verse 17, and this verse comes just before. And you know, we've been talking in the book of Colossians about the resurrected life, and teaching on it, and how the Christian life is so different than the life of the world. And the Christian home, and the family, the married husband and wife, it's just it's a totally different background and outlook than the world has. And so tonight I want us to look at this and kind of see what God has to say to us. But let's begin with this scripture. And whatsoever you do in word or in deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God, the Father, and by Him. Amen. So in this is the backdrop. This is the essence of everything that we do in life. Even as our role as a husband, or our role, your role as a wife, that in everything we do, that it be honor and glory to our Heavenly Father. And the Christian life is just so different. It's a total opposite of the world and the outlook that the world has. And really, as the world today is becoming more apparent, as it contradicts everything that the Bible has to say about the home, about the relationship between husbands and wives. And so tonight, I want us to look at it. So this is the guiding principle for all Christians to live by. Husbands, listen to me closely tonight, as well as the wife, that we realize that all that we do in the name and honor of the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So now we come to verse number 18 of Colossians, chapter number 3. Verse number 18. Wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands, as it is fit in the Lord. Now the meaning, let me kind of take this now, and I want to go maybe in a direction that you haven't heard this presented to you before, but I thank you when I get finished tonight, you'll say, you know what, that's exactly right. Marriage is a divinely designed relationship. Marriage is a godly thing. And God designed marriage there in the Garden of Eden between Adam and Eve. And throughout all of the centuries of time, God had put His blessings upon marriage, the union of a man and a woman as they come together, divinely appointed by God, in a divinely appointed way, as divinely appointed by God. So I want us to look tonight, marriage. Marriage is an earthly, visible example of man's relationship with God through salvation. And in a sense, in salvation, we become one in Christ. In marriage, man and woman, we become one together in Christ. And so, marriage is a picture of salvation. Marriage is an earthly, visible example that we can see and behold and cherish that we have together as we are one together with Christ Jesus. And when we're saved and born again, we become one in Christ. So when we become husbands and wives and our marriage is consummated, we become one person, one together in that relationship. It's almost like we're joined together as husband and wife is a picture of us being joined together with Christ as one. And that brings a whole different, beautiful picture of marriage and what it entails and what it involves, and helps us to realize that this is a holy matter when we come to talk about our relationship and husbands and wives and what this is a picture of. It is a picture of our relationship that God has given to us through His Son, Jesus Christ. So in marriage, we become one, committed to each other as long as we both shall live. Amen. How many times that I have performed those wedding vows and had them to repeat those wedding vows as long as we both shall live. Now to a child of God, to a Christian, that has a whole different meaning than it does to those who do not know the Lord. But to those of us who are saved, to those of us who have trusted Christ as our Savior, we realize that there's a depth of meaning in that that maybe the world does not yet understand or comprehend. But we have taken a vow unto God that as long as we both shall live, that we shall be committed to each other. And we know that even in our spiritual life, there are ups and downs, do we not? Spiritually, sometimes we realize that we have our ups and downs spiritually. And so we're not always as close to the Lord, maybe as we ought to be at some times in our walk with God. Sometimes even in a Christian marriage, the relationship is not always as it ought to be, as intimate as it ought to be. But we're still married. We still belong to each other. Even though our relationship with Jesus Christ is not always on the level that it ought to be, we're still a child of God. And we need to remember that and to honor that in our marriage. So in marriage we become one, committed to each other as long as we both shall live. But I just pause here to say eternal security that is established here. God never dies. And the child of God has eternal life. So as long when we committed ourselves to Christ and we became one in Christ Jesus, it was like our marriage is a picture of here upon the earth in that relationship. So we become a part of the body of Christ when we accept Jesus Christ as our Savior. And He said, I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. So as long as you both shall live. Now, God is going to live forever. Right. So now that part is settled. Right. Well, guess what? When we trusted Christ as our Savior, what did we receive? We received eternal life. So the both shall never end. So there's no death involved. So we are married to Christ, the body of Christ, forever and forever and forever. Can somebody say amen about it?
Amen.
So isn't that a wonderful relationship that we have? He said, I'll never leave you. Even though sometimes we're unfaithful. He said, I'll never leave you. There's times in our life that we are not as faithful to Him as we ought to be. But He said, I'll never leave you. So our relationship in marriage is eternal. And we see eternal security all wrapped up because God established marriage. He didn't establish it as a temporary relationship. Amen. Marriage is an eternal relationship. Amen. That God has established for Christians. And so tonight I wanted us to see that we have an eternal relationship with Jesus Christ. And marriage is a picture, is a type, if you want to use that word. A picture, a type, a model of what Jesus Christ has for you and I as we live for God and serve the Lord. So, well, let me just read a few more verses here. Verses 19, if we could just kind of. It says, husbands, love your wives and be not bitter against. Aren't you glad God loves you tonight?
Amen.
God loves you with all of his heart. Loves you so much. And he says over in Ephesians chapter 5 and verse number 23 that Christ is the head of the church. He loves the church. He gave himself for the church, the body of Christ. And so he loves us so much. And I'm saying all of that tonight. I'm bringing just a little bit up here, Paul Kettleman. I'm saying all of that tonight to say this. Christ loved us and gave us an example, men, of how we ought to love our wives. Aren't you glad God never gave up on you?
Amen.
And we should never give up on our relationship with each other. And because we made a commitment, Christians, wives and husbands, we made a commitment to each other until death do us part. Now, we may die here on this earth, but God has given to us eternal life, and we're going to live forever and forever. And Christ is the head of the church, and we're to obey Him and to follow Him as an example. And so the Bible says, husbands, love your wife. So in Ephesians 5:23, I wanted to quote that. Christ is the head of the church. He loved the church, and He gave Himself for it. Does that present a model, an example, if you will, for you and I, men, as to how we're to nurture our relationship with our wives? Now, it's not, you know, we expect so much out of someone else, but often we expect so little out of ourselves. And so as men, how much should we expect out of ourselves? Well, the example ought to be, we look at how much we look at Christ. How forgiving, how long-suffering, how gentle, how kind He is to you and I. And we're in kind of in the role of position that a wife would be in as we are to obey the Lord Jesus Christ as the head. And so husbands have a role, a role model to follow, and that role model is God. So men, if you want to know how to treat your wife, if you want to know how to respond to your wife, then look at how God responds to you. And that will give us a wonderful example. And I, you know, the old saying goes, you get a whole lot more out of sugar than you do salt. And so if we treat our wives like God treats us, we're going to have a happy marriage.
That's right. Amen.
We're going to have a happy home. We're going to have a great relationship. And so many times, you know, men think that they dominating one. Well, you know, I'm glad God's merciful. I'm glad God is long-suffering and tender toward us. And He doesn't expect perfection. Because if God expected perfection out of me, I'd be forever lost. But thank God He's a loving, kind, forgiving, and I can have a great relationship with the Lord Jesus, even though I'm not perfect.
Amen.
And so marriages can have a great relationship, husbands and wives, even though neither one is perfect. And so we need to remember that. We all have our shortcomings. And sometimes, you know, well, the men say, well, God says you're to obey me. Well, do you obey God? I think the wife could come back and say, well, when you start obeying God, I'll start obeying you. Boy, that'll shut you up in a hurry, won't it? But all of this is given to us. You know, we live in this world, but we're not of this world. We have a different standard, a different beat that we go by. And the world has influenced too much of the Christian home and family. And marriage, divorce is rampant. All because we've gotten away from the instruction. I talk about among Christians. In Christian homes, marriages, divorce is way too rampant. Why? Because we've gotten away from the principle,
right,
and the example set down in the Word of God. And I'm glad tonight to know that, you know, no matter what I do, God loves me.
Amen.
And husbands are to love their wives. And they're supposed to be that gentleness, that kindness, that long suffering that I've been talking about. Over in Ephesians 5:25, look at that verse. For the husband is the head of the wife. We'll do it. Husbands, love your wives. Well, that puts a great load on husbands, on the men. God loves us. He gave us an example of love. Now, we're to show that same example of love to our wives. The church is the bride of Christ. You and I tonight, spiritually sitting, we sit in the position of the bride. And Christ is the head. So it says, husbands, love your wife, even as Christ also loved the church. And he sacrificed himself for it. Men, if we're not willing to sacrifice in every way for our homes, our wives, our relationship, then we're missing the boat. Because we're missing the spiritual application that we as men, husbands, are to exhibit in our relationship to our wives. Our children need to see it. And when our children see a rebellious, dictatorial type spirit, they don't see what God wants them to see in our home. So, husbands, we are to love our wives. Boy, I'll tell you, if you love your wife like God loves the church, you're going to have a happy home.
Right.
You're going to have a great marriage. But whenever you quit loving your wife like Christ loved the church, then things are going to go awry in your marriage. You're going to miss the wonderful, the beauty, the love, the intimacy, and all that goes with marriage. And it all comes back on the burden doesn't fall on the wife to obey. The burden falls upon the husband to love.
Amen.
And when the husband loves, the wife will melt. Amen.
Amen.
And so, if your wife is not submissive, maybe it's because you're not loving her like Christ loved the church. Ladies, you can say amen to that. So this is the bottom line. Oh, we want to demand this. We want to demand that. You never get anywhere like that. You never will. And that's not a happy marriage. That's not the kind of marriage that God has ordained for man and woman here upon this earth. And he said, men, love your wife just like I love you. Just like I love the church. And the church is the bride of Christ. And so, men, we have to put ourselves in that position.
Wow.
And then once we do that, we can begin to understand the position that our wives are in with us. But there's a lot of rebellious spirit against the Heavenly Father, the head of the church, even from within the church. And that does not make for a good relationship. It's hard to have a revival. And a revival, what is a revival? A revival is a revival of love relationship between the church, the bride, and God. That's a revival.
Amen.
If you want to have a revival in your home, then there has to be that renewing of that relationship between husbands and wives. Men, the burden of all of that really rests upon us. To create that atmosphere. To create that desire within the home. God has given us so much love. He has created a wonderful environment. A relationship for you and I to love Him with all of our hearts. I mean, there's no reason for us not to love God.
Amen.
Think about it. There's no reason at all. So, in verses 18 and 19 of Colossians chapter number 3, it says, wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands, as it is fit in the Lord. So this, God has set a pattern. Everything fits together when we do it God's way. Amen?
Amen.
And it's a happy home. It's a joyful life. There's not a better life to live than a God-ordained married life. It's just wonderful. And in order to go to heaven, you've got to be married to God. And that's a wonderful life to live here. But God has gave us this model that we have in our homes between husbands and wives. So, the husbands have a role model to follow. He gives us freedom to live, to make decisions, Think about that. We're the wife. God is the husband. But he gives us freedom. God doesn't say, you either do this or I'm going to whoop you and kill you or destroy you. No, he's so kind. And we need to see that as husbands, we need to realize God gave us a lot of leeway. And thank God he doesn't strike us down and get upset with us and mad at us every time we disobey. So, he leads us and he guides us, but he gives us freedom to make our own decisions. And we are in the position of a wife, man, as Christians in salvation. God is the head. And if we don't expect our marriage to be like that, then we've got to be submissive to God. And so he leads us and he guides us, but gives us freedom to make our own decisions, even if they are not pleasing to him. Now, shall we give our wives, men, the same freedom that God gives to us? The freedom to live. The freedom to make their own decisions. Sometimes we may not always agree with those decisions. God doesn't always agree with our decisions. But he still claims us. And he still nourishes us. And he still loves us. And he still takes care of us. And loves us. And so, just because we're married and husband and wife and we become one, doesn't mean that we always are in perfect agreement on all things. I wish I could say tonight that I was always in the will of God. I wish I could say tonight that I always agreed with everything God wanted me to do. There's been times we've all rebelled. And we see that in our earthly relationship. If we're going to have that, if that is true in our relationship to God, and we know in our own heart there's times that, you know, we want to go our own way, do our own thing, we rebel. Well, you know what? We have to expect to see some of that, even in our own relationship, husband and wife. And so, God is, I put that in verse 18 and 19. Look at verse 19. Let's go there. Husbands, love your wives and be not bitter against them. So God is not a dictator, and neither should a husband be.
Amen. Amen.
Hopefully, this will give us a proper understanding how God has established marriage. And we look at our relationship to God and how we respond to Him gives us a little picture of our relationship on earth with husband and wife. Because this would be an earthly model, an earthly picture, if you will, of our heavenly relationship between us and Jesus Christ. Amen. And so, you know, I wish we could all say, boy, I've always pleased God perfectly. But you know what? We haven't. And there's no perfect pleasing in marriage. But we still love. But we still are kind. And we're still gentle. And we're still long-suffering with each other. So, as we look at that relationship, I want us to, every time we think about our wives, men, think about how God looks at us. And then you look at your wife accordingly in the same way that you know God looks at you. He looks at you with love and compassion and long-suffering and tenderness, kindness. And then, if we look at our wives in that same way that God looks at us, we're going to have a wonderful relationship one of the most wonderful experiences that man could ever experience here upon earth. And so the model, the perfect model is the Lord Jesus. He's the perfect husband. And so if I want to know how to treat my wife, I say, how is God treating his wife? And then I know how to respond to my wife. If you're talking about enjoying marriage, it will be the most wonderful, enjoyable experience man can have on the face of the earth. But if you try to become a dictator, if you by time I can say, well, it's my way or the highway, you better get ready to hit the highway. But God doesn't do that. And neither should Christians. We all love each other. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Well, I hope tonight that you have seen the beauty of marriage. How this relationship is a picture of our relationship to the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's stand together. Thank you so much. Our Heavenly Father tonight, Lord, marriage is such a beautiful and wonderful experience. Blessed is, Lord, that you've given to us here upon the earth. But Lord, it's a wonderful picture also of how you love us and how you have come into our hearts, into our lives, and we become one person, one creature in Christ Jesus. Where old things passed away, now we become one new body in Christ. Lord, when we come together as married, we become one. We become one together, not two separate souls, but almost like our souls come together as one. And Lord, thank you, Lord, that with you it is inseparable. And in our lives, in our married lives, as husband and wives, it should also be inseparable. God, give us grace and knowledge. Give us, dear Lord, help and strength and blessing upon our Christian marriages. Lord, bless our homes. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. And God bless you.
Singing, leaning on the everlasting arm. 460. Decisions have got to be made. And let's pray for wisdom.
for our president and for all of those who are making those decisions. Let's pray and read us this. Father, thank you for this time together tonight. And we do pray for our church. We pray for our nation. We ask, dear God, that Thou would just lead and guide and give wisdom to those in authority over us, dear God. And that bless our church and our people, wherever they are in their homes tonight. May you bless them in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you and God bless you.